session for the Norfolk City Council will now commence. Mr. Roberts, the floor is yours.
All right, sir. Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council members, if you can, I'll just provide a brief overview of the agenda for the work session today. I've added an item, so if there's no objections from council, I would like to add at the beginning a brief overview. This can be given by Kyle Spencer, Chief Resilience Officer of item R6 on your 7 p.m. agenda. Deals with the declaration of restrictive covenants. So again, if there's no objections, we'll add that as a brief presentation. The first scheduled presentation we have following that, we have Ted Baruti, CEO of Norfolk Fest Events. He's here to provide the Fest Events annual report. Following that, we have the city planning update, which will be provided by Mr. George Homewood, Director of Planning. We also have an extensive presentation by Public Works staff tonight, and that's the capital improvement program projects which are underway, including several that are ARPA-funded or federally funded neighborhood projects. Richard Broad, Director of Public Works, is here, along with a couple of his staff who will provide highlights on a number of projects that are underway, and they're here to answer any questions you have about what is a very vast and extensive CIP this year. Following that, John Stevenson, Director of Transit, is here to provide an update on the LED replacement project, which is a citywide project to span a little over the next 3 years. We have a commercial corridors update provided by Sean Washington, Director of Development. And we have a couple of closed session items for review of City Council. If there's no questions or objections, I'll call up Mr. Spencer, Chief Resilience Officer.
Objection.
Good evening, Mayor, members of council. I'll just take a couple minutes to explain item R6 on the agenda tonight.
So as part of our Brownfields grant that the city received in 2018 and the interim use park there that we built along the shoreline, we had to enroll the red outlined area in what's called the volunteer remediation program with the Department of Environmental Quality. And to close that program out, now that the project is finished, we're asking you to give the city manager permission to sign that certification, which will close out the city's obligation there. And what that is basically going to do is say, for the red outlined area, there's no first floor residential structures allowed. So there is some contaminated soils, but they're not kind of a low level contamination, but no first floor elevation, residential properties, no groundwater use of the property, which we don't really allow in the city anyway. And any earth movement activities would require a soil management plan, which we've already created for either a potential developer or for the flood wall project. And so the docket item is just sort of authorizing the city manager to sign that certification that DEQ has already signed and move that forward so we can close that item out.
Kyle's project's been in the works for about 4 years, so this is just an administrative matter to close.
Exactly,
2018 is when we received that grant, and it was a $500,000
grant to assess the site and do that work. So just finishing that up.
Any questions for Kyle or Mr. Roberts? Thank you, Kyle.
Thank you, Mayor. Next up, again, the first scheduled presentation, I'd like to invite to the podium Mr. Ted Baruti. In its 40th season, Fest Events has provided the City of Norfolk with an extensive annual schedule of diverse cultural events, festivals, concerts, and holiday programs presented in two popular and welcoming waterfront environments, Sail Point Park and Ocean View Beach Parks. Tonight, Mr. Baruti, CEO, is here to celebrate what brings us together as he provides Fest Events 2022 accomplishments. I'd also like to take a moment and recognize Ms. Karen Scherberger, Executive Director of CL250. Also, you recognize her as Executive Chairman of Norfolk Fest Events. Karen says she's here for moral support. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Great introduction. Mr. Mayor, Vice Mayor, City Council, thank you very much for having me today.
I also want to, before we reflect back on the Fest Events season, just thank the senior management team for all their help and support throughout this year. WCity Manager Roberts has been very helpful early in the year. Catherine, Pete and I worked on a job fair together earlier in the year. Lavoris and I seem to cross paths a lot, but we really couldn't do what we do without Ms. Trista Pope. So, Trista, thank you for all the support. You're looking at some good pictures here of the first ever drone show flown over the Elizabeth River here on the downtown Norfolk waterfront. One of our special memories from this past year as we recap the year. You can see a great spelling out of Norfolk there. That was 60 drones, red, white, and blue, that made that happen. But just a quick snapshot of the year, some of our headlines and top stories and the news to know. You know, this was our first full season since the pandemic, and so it was really special, both for the staff, but also all of the residents and attendees that got to come back to especially the spring season of events. This was the first time in a couple years there hadn't been a spring wine festival, there hadn't been a Bayou Boogaloo, there hadn't been a Harbor Fest in a while. So it was really special to bring things back to action. For us, it was even more special because we were getting the hugs and the high fives. You know, we're built to be in motion. We're built to be in the public. We're the memory makers here on behalf of the city. And so it was a really neat year as a whole to flash back to. It was also special because we could do our second annual Juneteenth in the park celebration. We had gotten to tease that the year before in 2021. But this year, we actually had to plan it. We got a nice committee together. We're already looking forward to 2023. We got to launch our new event, Nash Fest, that got some national recognition. You'll see here in a little bit. And together with Men for Hope, as well as the Virginia Arts Festival, we had the inaugural Gospel Fest that was a very good, successful event back in September. So again, just fun to reflect back on all the things that happened. A lot in this room can remember all the work that went into the Patriotic Festival and bringing back some of the outside groups. This was our first year managing some of those programs, supporting seven venues with groups like NATO Fest, Pride Fest, Carib Fest. All went very well. Most got good weather, which was also nice. And you'll see here a little bit later, even though our season is always very diverse, this was probably our most diverse season we've ever had in our 40 years. Safety and security remained a top priority. We have one event left on the calendar this Saturday with our holiday celebration. But the worst we had to deal with all year was just a couple of Band-Aids. And so, you know, knock on wood and keep our faith for a good week this week. But that was really important. And especially with Norfolk Police, Norfolk Sheriffs, a private security team we worked with this year, it was not just important to keep things healthy and well on site, but obviously safe and secure. That's all that's been going on in the world. And that's where some of the partnerships were so key. And I really think we did well with just following the trends of what we, the consumers, like to do and don't like to do these days. And that really showed in our attendance. There were two events I really wanted to acknowledge, and this is more probably a personal note than anything, but having the Jazz Festival back and having it outside was just a really special moment for us. Not just for the locals, but that event attracts people from just about every state in the country. And they come to Norfolk for the weekend. They love our city. They love to see the city. They want to get out. They want to eat. They stay in the hotels. And it's just a really special weekend to have them back. Also for us, we Fest events are 40 years old, but some of these events are now turning 40 years old. And so Jazz Festival will be 40 years old in 2023. And then the growth and expansion of Latino Festival, the Norfolk Latino Music Festival. We really saw a big jump having that back in full form this year. You'll see some fun pictures there on the screens from the great crowds. You know, we start early in the days a little more family with soccer and family programming and such, but we end the day with some pretty good big live music. The whole downtown waterfront is dancing, so it's a great time to be outside and see it live and in person. In fact, this is one. I'd love to come back in the spring and talk about 2023, but this event has got the potential to now grow. It's been a one-day event, and we'd love to see this one grow longer, bigger, maybe extend throughout more of the weekend. We still remained a national performance venue, both here and at Ocean View Beach Park. This year we saw and hosted more than 400,000 visitors, which was great, 175 days of community programming, and more than 80 national acts there. Ocean View Beach Park, again, saw great numbers. This was, if there was, you know, a bright star to come out of the pandemic, additional people attending the Ocean View Beach Park events was one of those. We saw good attendance in 21 and then even a greater attendance here in 22 that continues to grow. So by the numbers, a great economic impact story for the city of Norfolk. Just fest events alone, so far this year, we've paid more than $100,000 in admission taxes. You'll see we're getting close and we'll cross $30,000 in sales and meals taxes. Our food vendors have crossed the $60,000 mark. Our retail sales have crossed 45, or will by the end of the year cross $45,000. You see the permit fees and such. Parking, we have to track through our survey data, so it's not an exact science, but I feel like this is a very conservative number. And by the end of the year, we'll easily cross $800,000 there for parking. And then what we do through these surveys, this is on-site at the events. The guests will get an iPad, and one of our staff will work with them through the iPad survey. And we ask them, what did you spend your money on? Where are you going next? We ask them just 5 or 10 simple questions. But we ask, how much did you spend and where did you spend it? And we've tracked so far this year more than $35 million that the guests went out and spent or spent at the event, which is pretty impressive, again, coming out of the pandemic. We Fest Events alone, we'll probably spend $2.5 million back into the local economy, just ourselves. And then we feel like as a platform for all the local businesses that come out, and these are the food vendors and the retailers, they'll probably reach about $2 million. We're currently at $1.7 million right now. So as a whole, we're hitting that $1 million mark direct back to the city, and that doesn't include hotel rooms and restaurants and all the sales and meals tax that comes from the hotel rooms and local restaurants. So it's a great economic picture as well. Media and tracking the meeting is always important to us. We'll hit the $300 million impression mark by the end of the year. This is about $1.2 million if you had to buy the media coverage. A lot of that had to do with just some basic media stories, some national, some local. A lot of it was based on just being back in that full swing. This is something we're real proud of. If you kind of looked at us digitally, especially from a website perspective, we're number 2 as far as all the entertainment arts organizations. We are just behind the Virginia Beach Amphitheater. We need to cross that next year. But it's a great story. It really is. And we're by far the leader in social media, especially with just general followers like you find on Facebook and such. It's even more interesting when you break it down by city, who's touching these digital platforms. You'll see the city of Virginia Beach, guests of Virginia Beach, one. Norfolk's high up there, as we'd expect. But also look there. You've got Baltimore, New York, cities like Philadelphia and Richmond, also there in the top 15. And that's a great story. I think some of that tracks some of the VTC advertising money. That certainly helps. They advertise in a lot of these cities, and then people come to the city's website, our website. They decide they want to come and celebrate. I'd mentioned we received some great national recognition this year, really international recognition. This is our event association that we're a big part of called IFEA, the International Festival and Events Association. We won a gold award for that new event we called NashFest. We have 4 others for different things, some of our artwork, some of our social media and digital work. Speaking of Virginia Tourism, we received 2 grants from them this year, which was a nice addition to some of the funding we need to help pull off our season. Also with IFEA, it was really interesting this year. One of the new programs, you know, we always try to do these sort of wow, you know, large moments like those drone shows over the waterfront. And then we want to have these kind of little aha moments and more subtle, just high impression, but maybe they're more of a subtle approach to things. And this was one of those more subtle programs we activated this year. And it was a sensory inclusive area. And so at all the premier events this year, you saw the trailer. It's a little bit hard to see there in the bottom right corner, but there's a trailer that's mobile, and it's a mobile sensory room. We partner with a company called Culture City. They're the national leaders in sensory training, sensory rooms, sensory devices. They do all the big arenas, all the big new arenas across the country. They work with Major League Baseball, NFL, NHL, all the major league sports. So we felt like they were the good ones to go to. But we were recognized at IFEA. Myself and one of their board members, a young man he and his family have wrestled with autism throughout his life, got to speak in front of the entire conference and show off our program and all that Norfolk's doing to be sensory inclusive, especially at our outdoor event. So that was a nice piece of recognition. Our community development program continued, and this one was a little bit altered during COVID on purpose. We tried to be more strategic with some of the small businesses that were struggling. This picture here is one of our small businesses. It's a jeweler that came out to the Latino Festival. And again, this is a program where we work directly with the small business. A lot of these are, you know, one and two person owned businesses. We become an extension of their staff. We teach them how to market. We teach them how to sell. They get a free booth space. We'll make them their banners. We'll teach them how to do social media. It was one of the better stories for the year. But that continued this year. Part of this program is our charitable donation that we give back out to all the different fundraising groups that come participate. You'll see a great list of organizations, very diverse organizations there on the left. We had some new clubs we added this year. The Minority Aid Support Services, Samaritan House, World Class Gymnastics were all new this year. But we're proudly tracking to do more than $55,000 in donations back out to these charities. A little bit again by the numbers. This is our guest survey data. This is all accumulated throughout the year. Now again, I'm a little biased. I'm at every event. We're all at all these events. If you came to some events this year, you got to see how diverse age, socially, racially, how diverse the programming was. And I would actually argue that it's even better than the numbers show, but we're going to go by the data, what we have and what we can track. But again, you'll see a great different a variety of makeup of who attended. And then also important on this slide is just that they have a better impression of Norfolk after they leave the event. And they have a great impression of the city as a whole. So again, very good data to receive, especially after a year coming off the pandemic. I'll take any questions or any comments.
Thank you, Ted, for the presentation. Mr. May.
Ted, did I miss it? AFRAM Fest, whatever happened to AFRAM Fest?
AFRAM Fest, you know, went away about 10 or so years ago. There is some talk to, you know, between some of these new programs like Juneteenth, the Gospel Fest, how do we take some of the good and some of the good programming from AFRAM? In fact, Councilman Royster has recommended that as well. Can we take some of that good programming that was at that festival weekend and merge into some of these new platforms we have?
Do you have space? I mean, on your calendar.
Yeah, the calendar is tight. I mean, there's always room, but the calendar is tight, especially since we've added two or three new events, such as Juneteenth and Gospel Fest.
To add on to Councilman Riddick's point and the discussions we and Ted have had, I think it's great that chart that you had showing the diversity for the attendance. Mm-hmm. But when we look at you know, things like Juneteenth, mm-hmm. Gospel Fest, and some type of hybrid perhaps of AFRAM, I think it would be vital to make sure A, we bring those voices to the table who were instrumental in making AFRAM Fest happen.
That's right.
So that they can lend, you know, their ear as well as their connections to that, as well as to make sure we're continuing this legacy of things to be proud of in the city, making sure we're bringing in some young voices as well,
mm-hmm.
because ultimately we want these festivals not only to, you know, trigger one demographic, but for people to feel like I was a part of this too.
Yeah,
so, you know, working with, you know, Norfolk State University, mm-hmm. working with, you know, the historical societies and throughout mm-hmm. the city, as well as engaging, you know, some of our younger people as well,
yeah.
so that they can be a part of this process, as well as making sure we're not missing any gaps on why this percentage, we didn't seem to get them there
yeah.
this year.
Yeah.
And you can't have people who don't represent that percentage
right.
speaking on it
right.
unless you have those people
right.
at the table.
Right.
So that would just be a recommendation that I have.
No, those are great recommendations. The fact that one of the new events did
come from some young people that may not be from me, it's some of the staff perspectives. We still lean on committees a lot, especially for some of these more community-based events like Latino Festival and Juneteenth, but no, great points. We did just brand new, 3 weeks old now, hire a young woman named Destiny Wright. Used to be with the MEAC conference team here in town. And her sole job is going to be some of that community outreach. She's a little younger than some of us that have been around a little longer, which would certainly help as well. But great points. I wrote them all
down. Ted, any additional comments, questions, remarks, reflections from Ted? Thank you, sir.
All right,
thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Awesome.
Appreciate that.
Mr.
Yeah.
Roberts.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Next, we have the city planning update. I'll invite Mr. Hunley to the podium.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. Dr. Mayor, Members of Council, Mr. Deputy Manager, thank you for having me. I'm going to cover some items for that are coming up tonight, as well as all of the items from the Planning Commission that you'll be hearing at your December meetings. So you don't have to hear from me again until sometime after the first of the year. Hopefully that's good news. So the first thing I want to talk about is the East Beach Marketplace. There's two phases to it. Phase one is a residential component. Phase two is a commercial component. These are on tonight's agenda. And so the first is the residential, and it's essentially to take half of the East Beach Marketplace Shopping Center, demolish it, and build apartments in its place. And that would be on the western side is where the apartments would be. The eastern side would remain as it is. This is their current plan, which is a little different than what was submitted to the Planning Commission, but fairly close. It's a four-story building, 96 total units instead of the 92 they were originally proposing. And you can see the breakdown of studio ones and two-bedroom units. City Planning, the reason we're talking about today is City Planning Commission, by a vote 6-0, is recommending denial. And the reason for that is that there is the developer is unwilling to commit to putting in workforce units as part of the development. As you all know, ever since the adoption of the multifamily design principles, every single multifamily project outside of downtown, and the reason for outside of downtown is downtown doesn't require conditional use permits. Everywhere else, multifamily does require a conditional use permit. Every single one of the conditional use permits for multifamily since that was adopted has included some degree of workforce or inclusionary, and in some cases even voucher housing. So this was because the applicant was not proposing that, Planning Commission unanimously recommended denial. Both before and subsequent to the Planning Commission meeting, staff and the applicant have worked together. We've tried to find some way to get to a happy median. We've not been able to do so. What has happened is that originally this was 92 units. They've redone it to create some additional studio, four additional studio units that would be in there. For a total of 96, but we just haven't really been able to find an agreement on those workforce units. I will mention that the approval also includes granting a waiver for less than 50% of the ground floor in this zoning district to be non-residential, and it also and the conditions that are in the ordinance that was considered by the Planning Commission. Also require that the new utilities be placed underground, as well as any relocated utilities. The developer indicated to me yesterday some concern with that, and so may be speaking about that today. So just
the only thing I'd interject on this, the result on the affordable housing not being included here is not on the part of the housing staff. Well, city manager's office staff has been in contact with the applicant for the last several weeks. I think all the council is aware that market conditions have changed in recent months, and I think this developer and his partners face a real hip and it's coming into this. So, as recently as last week, they thought that they would have been able to add a number of units to the group as early this week. It's not possible this time. So, that's the result.
Let me throw some numbers out for you just so you know. So the standard condition, what we were talking about is 9 units. The standard condition requires those 9 units be available for people at 80% of area median income. What does that mean? Well, it means for one person, that's $52,400. Which is approximately what we pay planners and firefighters and teachers. For two people, it's $59,850, and for a family of four, it's $74,800. That's the assumed, that would be the 80% area median income that would be the target. And that would lead to a target rent for, essentially, for a studio of $900 a month, a one-bedroom of $1,100 a month, and two-bedroom of $14. Those are really round numbers that include a bunch of assumptions about utilities and things like that. But that just gives you an idea of what the magnitude is. Those numbers are actually not that far off of the actual median rents that are received in the city of Norfolk. I checked those out today using Zillow. And so the median current median rent for overall is $1,450. And that includes apartments and houses. For studio apartments, it's $1,025. For one bedrooms, it's $1,043. And for two bedrooms, it's $1,331. Those are the current monthly median rents that are received in the city of Norfolk. Just, you know, not trying to convince you of anything, just giving you numbers for you to think about going forward. Mr. Smigel, did I cut you off, sir? I apologize.
I've had discussions with a few council members about this project. As a council, we've been talking for how many years about an inclusive housing policy somewhere in there, and we have never voted on a policy. We've had, hold on, Andrea, what? We've had discussions, tons of discussions about this, but we do not have a policy as a city on this. And one of the things that I have talked to Chip about on multiple projects is planning staff and planning commission are to not write policy for the city. Okay, if they want to recommend policy, which we haven't had a recommendation of this, and yes, there's the plan 2030, which mentions this, but that is not policy. That is a recommendation. We have to be careful with, this is a, to me, is a proffer. And proffer laws in Virginia, and I see this repeatedly on multiple projects that come before council or complaints from those who want to do business in Norfolk, and I get it. I want us to get whatever we can out of projects. But we are crossing a fine line on some of these projects, particularly when this is a private property. This is a private developer. This is not public property. So if we own this right across the street, there was conversation about an apartment building that we own, but we ended up going in a different direction with that one because we didn't have policy. And I'm just continuously troubled when I see recommendations from staff, which it does influence the Planning Commission and their decisions on these. And so when this was mentioned, I was at both Civic League meetings when this was brought to East Ocean View Civic League and Camellia Shores, and there was never any conversations about market rate. It was all market rate. It was never about inclusionary, and that's how they both voted. I was actually surprised Camellia Shores. But when we talk about policy two and where we're looking, directly across the street from this is a census tract that has 19.7% poverty in it. 19.7% poverty. This one is in a census tract that's 3.8, but less than 50 feet. And so when we're talking about where these, now if you put this down the street, you know, we'd be in a different situation because there's less poverty. But I'm troubled about we don't have a policy first. We don't have anything in writing. We don't have any incentives for any developers to do this either. That I'm aware of to say, hey, if you include this. But we need to be careful with the fine line when it comes to proffering because the proffer laws of Virginia continue to change. They go one direction and they change the other. And so I'm supportive of inclusion. And this developer, it's actually the shopping center has hired a developer to do this. It's a shopping center owner that wants to do this, which, by the way, this is an old model of a shopping center. Right, it does not work anymore with all the asphalt. They're redoing it. The next presentation, I don't know if it's going to show the shopping strip. Are you talking about that?
Just the new.
So it's not just an apartment building. They're actually putting a shopping strip they're redoing it in front. So this is a commercial, and it's a mixed-use project. So it's not just apartments. The shopping strip passed planning, but this did not because of that. I'm going to be making a motion later to amend this, to take that condition out. And I'm sorry that this is there. And I also disagree. I've gone back and forth about the undergrounding of power lines. I think on-site, when a developer does it, we should do that. But we keep on asking developers to spend millions, sometimes in cases, extra money for our infrastructure woes that we allowed to happen years ago. And to go in and underground power lines, which, by the way, usually is just the power that's underground. It's not the Verizon or the other lines. So you still have poles there with wires. It's just taking the power and putting it underground. That is a problem. And Martin and Courtney, you guys know, and Andrea at Ward's Corner, how much it costs to underground. Now we're asking that to put that onto a developer. And we just, as a city, we come across sometimes as not being developer friendly. I'm troubled that we don't have a policy, but I also want us to try to maximize these projects, but do it as a partnership, not as that when the people come to the table after they've already gone through some processes and then we say, oh no, you got to do this, or no, you got to do this. And some of that does happen, some of it is forward with it. But I'll talk to Bernard about making an amendment to this later. But we need a policy. And Andrea, you and I have talked about an incentive, right? What's the incentive for a developer to move away some of their units out of market? Is it less parking requirements? Is it, what is it? What do we do to incentivize them?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. McCollum.
I agree. We don't have a policy. Why don't we have a policy? Is it because of restrictions set at the state level? That's a question I have. Or is it that we haven't had the political will to vote on a policy?
Right.
And if it's the latter, shame on us. You can't point fingers that we don't have a policy when we're the ones creating the policy. So how do we get a policy to be voted on? Because I think you can't, listen, I represent Super Ward 6. A lot of the affordable housing ends up in Super Ward 7, and that's not fair. It's got to be throughout the entire city. Unless we have an inclusionary policy that is, to your point, throughout the entire city, developers are not going to have to do it. Should there be incentives too? Absolutely. The governor had a conference about affordable housing this past week. He seems to be all in. The state and the city need to provide those incentives. But to argue that we don't have a policy, so we shouldn't do it, well, policy making is our job. We've got to step up and put that policy out there and create one. Affordable housing is the biggest risk to economic development for our city and our region. If people can't afford to live here, they can't work here. And so I hear what you're saying, and it's not fair necessarily to the developer on this project because we don't have a policy in place. But my God, we've got to do something. We can't keep saying it's their fault. We've got to do something ourselves. In terms of underground power lines, I hear what you're saying. We can't afford to do it. Dominion can't afford to do it. If the developer is willing to do it, I'd love for that to happen. I mean, we have hurricanes, we have natural disasters here. We've got to start creating a policy for that as well. So that's
so
just
my
soapbox.
Would be to let them work that out in the site plan. I don't know if it should be a condition. I think it should be something that you work with the developer on and say, what can you do? And there might be some grant funds through Dominion to also assist with that, which is done at other projects. But, you know, we talked about the missing middle, you know, and where are we with that? You know, and it's like this could have been an example of a missing middle, you know, project that if we had started in advance and working with the developer on.
Missing middle is really like the 8-packs and the 6-packs and the 10-packs. It's not 92.
Could you could have done that around that with the sizes of that site.
I would just say let's create a policy.
Yeah.
Mayor, I will add, too, because there has been an emphasis on the policy in this discussion. The manager is anxious to get back in front of the council after the first year with the housing staff to share some draft policies as well as some specific tools that, in a case like this, would enable the city to perhaps influence some of these additional units being set aside. We had hoped to have that before you by the end of the year. We'll work with an outside partner on that. So we hope to get that in front of you as soon as we can. We understand it's a problem.
Okay. Mr. Vidic, it was Johnson.
Yeah.
Tommy, one project that you championed was that Pleasant Avenue and Ocean View Avenue.
Yeah, the term.
That's a townhouse project.
Oh, so they don't, they're for sale.
Those are for sale.
Okay, yeah. But I don't think we should let this group get away, and I won't be on you guys, but I don't think we should let them get away with not providing workforce housing, regardless of what they say. It just means that they're going to take more money to the bank. Even if it just set aside 6 or 8 or whatever. But I think they should be just like everyone else and pitch in.
Can I ask a question before me? A legal question to proffering. I had sent you an email about another project that the planning staff has said that they have to put fire hydrants in and new water main where there's already poor infrastructure. Where do we reach a point where a developer or somebody could sue the city or fight this because we're forcing proffers? It's my understanding the proffer laws in Virginia it's all optional. It used to be that you could it was mandatory, but then something happened in Chesapeake, I think, and the law changed, and then it moved back to that it's optional, that a city can't force a developer to do something, but they can recommend it unless it's a city-owned property or something where we're rezoning. This is not a rezoning. This is a CUP, in a sense.
Right. You've done a good job of talking about the evolution of the proffer law.
For those who are watching, could you explain what the term proffer means? Because I don't think that's a normal term.
I think the definition of proffer is for somebody to offer it up. And so it has the voluntary question that Councilman Smeagol mentioned. So that you don't run into an issue under the regulation of the proffers if the petitioner is offering it. And so whether or not something is offered can be litigable, so litigable about whether this is really voluntary or I proposed it because I knew that you wanted it and I would get approval. And because of that dicey nature, we've pretty much gotten out of the business of proffers or seeking them. And so that the other element of it is whether the item is related or caused by the development. And so that we have the ability to require things that arise from the proposal. With the conditional use permit, you don't have the proffer per se. You have the question of whether it is within the proposed use of the particular land. I'm not aware of, and actually wasn't prepared for the question, on whether affordable housing for a CUP would be regarded as in the nature of a proffer. So I'm sorry, I can't be more definitive than that.
Mayor, I know we have some additional slides.
Maybe, I'm sorry, cut off maybe. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. When we talk about the word affordable, it's going to take the city of Norfolk to change that word that is so often used as negative into a positive. Affordable does not mean poverty stricken. It means everybody wants to have the opportunity to live in a safe, beautiful community, no matter what your income level is. And we have a lot of work that we have to do. As far as requiring developers to set aside what we identify as affordable, and when we talk about policy, we keep kicking it down the road. Every time a development comes before us, we look at it as though the next time. And so the next time continues to build up to many times. Super Ward 7, we are inundated with what is considered workforce housing. And sometimes, often, when we continue to focus on workforce housing, it doesn't give the communities an opportunity to balance itself off. And you have to be very careful. You have to have a clear picture of what you're looking at when you look at the neighborhoods. And nobody looks their neighborhood, their ward, with all due respect, better than I know Ward 3. I know every single community. And so it's taken years of studying and how to balance things off, because if we're not careful, you have what we consider the communities that have been able to be sustainable, they become our tipping point communities. And if you don't invest in those communities, then they too become poverty stricken. So we have to balance it out. Mr. Smigel, you did talk about that fine line, and there is that fine line. So with that fine line, we create the policy, and we should have done the policy a long time ago. Every time a development comes before us, we say we're going to take care of it, but we've never gotten to the policy part. And I've talked to Director Homewood about when it goes before the Planning Commission, and then it gets kicked back to us because nobody wants to make the decision. And so it's left up to us to make that decision. With the policy in place, that gives Mr. Homewood, the Planning Commission, a clear sight on what the expectations are of the council. There is no further discussion, the negotiation with developers. They want to be in Norfolk. But what isn't clear is what they can and cannot do. And so a lot of money is being spent where we really need them to spend the money. They're having to spend the money elsewhere. And so it takes up a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of discussion, and we're getting nowhere. So what I would say here tonight is that this council, as the governing body for policy making, that we make the decision to write that policy that will be clear for everybody who comes into the city of Norfolk to build or to do anything involving the Planning Commission, the Planning Department, and City Council. They will have a clear sight. And we have to think of a reverse. So if I'm trying to build my community or the communities in Ward 3, and if I say that, well, this development is going to be market rate, and so we get hit with, well, why do you want the market rate? Because we are tired of Super Ward 7 being the dumping ground for all affordable housing. It doesn't give the children, the families, a chance to grow. But one thing we did prove in Broad Creek is that it can be done. We have the data that shows that the generation that was there when we started the Hope 6, and that the city invested the money beyond Hope 6, the children now have better lives, and their children will have better lives, and we have the data to prove it. And that is the way that we should be looking for every community in the city of Norfolk. So that's what I'm looking forward to. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Manager. Thank you, George.
Quick question for you, just on clarity, because I see on the slides it says that the you all had the discussion recommendation based on lack of workforce units and you couldn't reach an agreement. But on our R1, it says the applicant has now agreed to a specified amount of inclusionary housing. So,
that was, again, what we learned yesterday, I believe, that they had to withdraw that commitment based on conversations that literally, I think, took place over the weekend with the business partner. So, when we went to print on this, we were under the impression that the developer had found a way to do it, but they've since withdrawn it.
Mr. Manager, so if that is true, up until the 11th hour, if we're finding what is presented before us to be untrue, why is it before us tonight?
Again, the matter was scheduled. We just learned of this literally, I believe it was midday yesterday. We thought to add it as an update and clarify this as the first item on the update, just so you're aware, this was literally something we scrambled to understand.
Right. The developer was the one that was working with the city to do it, but the person who owns the property cannot make the financing happen with the changes, I assume.
That's what we understood.
Yeah.
So, there was a question for you, Pat. Is this time sensitive? This is time sensitive and we have to vote on this tonight because there are a lot of unanswered questions from the impact on schools to the shopping center being reduced to 50% of its original footprint.
No, it's not.
Ground floor.
I don't know if you can go back to the
first floor, George, you presented that 50%
right.
of
so
the first floor residential.
You see the white part of the building, the shopping center? And the other one there, they're almost all vacant. So there's only three that are occupied. They're tearing down where Family Dollar, from Family Dollar down, and put it there, but they're putting a new shopping strip up front where the white building is up front. That's the new strip. So they're repositioning, which is, if you go out to Diamond Spring Road, Diamond Springs and Virginia Beach Boulevard and Virginia Beach, this is what's been happening out there. They've been taking these shopping centers, redeveloping them, putting apartments on them, so you create some kind of mass of people, and then you redo the shopping.
So George, the note I have, 50% of the first floor will be non-residential.
Dr. Mayor, this is one of those really confusing things. In order to get the project financed, the owner is having to subdivide the property and create two separate parcels, one on which the non-residential will remain, and then the other part is where the multifamily would be built. We had a long misunderstanding with the developer and what their intent was, and originally we looked at it and said, well, it's no big deal because the totality of the shopping center and the first floor square footage of the apartments still has more than 50% of that total ground floor square footage is non-residential. It was only when we became aware that this had to be subdivided that we realized that technically in this zoning classification, you have to have a conditional use permit to have less than 50% of the ground floor. Because it's on a separate parcel, then, you know, that's what we do the calculation on. If we were looking at the entire shopping center, the two parcels together, they're well more than 50% of non-residential between the remaining commercial in the shopping center plus what they're adding, which is the next application that we'll talk about. So it's a difference without a distinction in some ways. You asked the question about time sensitivity. I can't answer that question. The applicant would have to answer that question.
And then the undergrounding of the utilities, that seems to be still unresolved.
We as a standard require that all on-site utilities be placed underground.
There's a problem with that. It's the off-site.
And if you have to relocate utilities off-site in order to accommodate what you're doing, and in this case, there's a sidewalk being constructed along East Little Creek, which is going to cause some of those utilities to be relocated. If you're relocating them, you relocate them underground. That's again been a standard that we have used now for quite some time, ever since the 2018 zoning ordinance.
What I want to avoid is trying to rewrite this entire matter upstairs. If this needs more work, then let's commit to getting it done. To go upstairs and try to rewrite this entire matter is be very problematic and could create more problems for ourselves and the developer.
So is there anything restricting us from moving towards an inclusionary housing policy? It was my understanding that there's a problem with current state law that doesn't allow for us to do that. Bernard, do you know what that is, or is there any restriction for us?
There is enabling legislation, and I can't remember the percentage, but it limits us to requiring only a percentage of it. So our policy couldn't require 100%, but there's a percentage in the statute, and I think 10% is within the limit in the statute. So to answer your question, state law would permit us to require up to the maximum percentage an element of inclusionary housing.
And is that, I guess I would ask the question, best practices, is that being done in other communities around the Commonwealth? I don't know the answer to that. I'd like to know more about that. But to my colleague's points, I think we can't just talk about it and then the next developer say, oh, well, there's no policy, so.
So what an ideal situation would be, I mean, literally right in front of that shopping center is a trailer park. The only trailer park that will be left in Norfolk, and the average poverty in Norfolk is 17.9%, and directly across the street from this is 19.7%. So when we're dealing with this, the poverty issue, and how we want to define that 10% is, while Super Ward 7 does have the bulk of it, there are parts of Super Ward 6 that also have a higher percentage of poverty. Maybe not overall if you look at a super ward, but there are areas that are still sensitive, you know, to it. So are we gonna, where these developments are happening, are you looking at just that area? We can't keep on saying Super Ward. There's parts of Super Ward 7 that have no poverty. There are parts. I'm just saying. So what do we look at when we're looking at this piece? What do we look at it? I mean, you're looking at individual census boundaries. Are you looking at neighborhoods? Are you looking at what the problem with this? Right. The problem with this is that you have two civic leagues that were presented something.
I understand. I'm not specific to this. I'm
and the city
that.
Goes back and says, oh, no, you have to do this. Unlike what happened in Park Place, which we know that the civic leagues, I see Rodney over there, they had that discussion because inclusionary housing was part of that project. And so it was mentioned, it was discussed in the community. This is my problem with every single time this comes up, whether it's in Super Ward 7 or anywhere, is that are these discussions happening with the community because the city has said in advance to the developer, this is what our expectations are, this is what you should do, not after the fact, after they presented it. And that's a problem because now you're misleading the community with it as well.
We might have an ordinance in place, but we have design guidelines in place that we adopted, I believe, a couple of years ago. So it's not like this is surprise. I mean, the planning department's very clear about this when they meet with the developers. And the developers are saying, okay, those are guidelines, but I'm not required by law, so I'm not going to have to do this. And what I'm suggesting is we, as the governing body who can create policy, vote on it. Let's do something. That's all. But that's not for this project specifically. I hear what you're saying, Tommy. I understand. I don't think this is ready. I think this is a little opportunity for a little more massaging. But this has been a really good discussion, and I appreciate the opportunity.
So, Pat, I'm going to recommend that we continue to maybe the 6th or the 13th 13th. George, you think you have something? Maybe we can.
Maybe you can vote on the shopping center. That's an issue.
May I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I don't want to beat the dead horse, but I will say that categorically, at the pre-application here, pre-application meeting with staff, the applicant was told that there would be an expectation for inclusionary housing. So they knew that from the very beginning before they met with the neighborhood. All right. The next is phase two, which is requires a conditional use permit for a what we call a large-scale drive-through. We don't know who the drive-through is for. We just know that it is a speculative building that is being developed, and this is not at least bit unusual. It's how these things happen. And they want to set it up so that one of the units, the end unit there, if you see the bottom diagram, the unit that's sort of shaded in to the right, could have a drive-through. We don't know the details of any of this yet, where the message box would be, where the menu would be, or anything like that. Those would all be worked out at the site plan stage. This is just a conditional use permit. Given the fact it's surrounded entirely by non-residential uses other than the potential for the apartments that are being built by the same developer, there's no concern about having the drive-through. It was recommended for approval by the Planning Commission by a vote 5-1. The one vote was that the person saw this as being integrally related to the apartments that didn't have the workforce housing, and that was the reason for that one vote, as well as some concern about walkability issues. Again, this will include a sidewalk along East Little Creek.
Mayor, I want to make sure we address your question, so we'll put to George and perhaps to Kim, because the meeting on the 6th and there's a turnaround time, we would want to have an accurate ordinance in front of council to understand what you're being asked to vote on, as well as update the staff report, transmit a letter, so that the community and public can read and understand what council is considering. So, is that feasible to do so by the 13th?
You
could certainly do
it
by the
13th. Well, not to play the fool here, but the ordinance before council is one that we would be comfortable if it were adopted right now. So we will need to know what the changes are that council wants to see in that ordinance in order to be able to give to you what it is you want
to
have.
Public is seeing as a transmittal letter that's not accurate to what the developers requested. So it's either one.
But we can, whatever date you need, we can make it happen.
Look, the council, I think the council want to make sure that we put out accurate information. Sure, you vote on it tonight, but she shows that the developer applicant has agreed to the specified amount of inclusionary workforce housing, but that is incorrect information.
It was correct information when it was written. It became incorrect information as of yesterday.
We can clean that up being on the 13th if that's pleasure, council.
Yes.
The sidewalk that you mentioned, is that going to be the entire length of Little Creek Road along that entire shopping center, or just the portion that's being redeveloped?
It's just the portion that's being redeveloped. So
there's still two more blocks until it can reconnect with the rest of the sidewalk.
Yes, sir.
Which is what we've done with other projects, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I think for the sake of clarity, we should say December 13th, vote on both R1 and R2, and present the information that is current at the time so that we know what we're voting on and the public knows what we're voting on as well.
Okay. And just consider precedent. So I'm warning this council that if we do not have a policy in place, because I sat through the DePauw Hospital presentation from Buddy and his team, and nowhere was there conversation about inclusionary housing in that 400 unit apartment. So if you guys, I'm just telling you, without a policy, we are going down a very slippery.
We don't have a policy.
I know. So
I understand where you are.
And by
December 13th, we're not going to have a policy.
Right.
But the change that happened within the last 24 hours is the thing to me that's problematic. That I think is what we're trying to correct here.
I can also make a motion from the dais to amend it, to not include it. That's an option too tonight.
If the will of the council is that they want inclusionary housing in this, and that's why you want to change it, that's the why we're extending it. But if because there's no policy and we want to amend it, that could also be voted on tonight. Council has that authority to amend what's before us. But we need a policy. We can't just willy-nilly do this. I mean, there's 4 years.
I don't think that your amendment will survive to take it.
I don't know. I don't know. I haven't polled people, so.
Okay, we're good. December 13th is Tommy. Is that everyone's December
13th?
Okay, December 13th. December 13th.
May I continue, sir? Thank you. So the next one we want to talk about is a, and again is on tonight, and it is a CUP for a short-term rental in the Willoughby portion of the city at 1106 Toller Place. This is a five-bedroom single-family home, and the proposal is to operate it as a short-term rental for a unknown period of time. Ms. Lundy purchased this home in 2020, and she lived there with her father until recently when she relocated to Washington State because her partner was transferred there by the Navy. And she fully intends to return to Norfolk and to this house and wants a way to cover the mortgage during the time that she and her partner are assigned out to in Washington. And so the short-term rental is a way of essentially being able to cover making enough money to be able to cover the mortgage to keep the house that otherwise they might have to sell, which she doesn't want to do. Site photos, and see where it is. I will mention that there have been no calls for service, no complaints, no outstanding violations on this property. Nearby, there is essentially one that has been approved and is in existence. There's another one that is pending its business license approval that is nearby. But the Planning Commission recommends denial of this in response to a fairly significant amount of neighborhood concern about this. A couple of petitions, several people spoke against it at the Planning Commission public hearing, and the argument being that this is an area that is almost exclusively neighborhood residential, family-oriented, and to introduce a short-term rental, is just not conducive to maintaining that character of community, and so that was the Planning Commission recommends again 6-0, that this be denied. Are there any questions?
Any questions from Mr. Reddick?
My question, George, is this. Do you have enough staff to collect the fees? Are we current? You know, we're having all of these short-term rentals, and fees that, if there were no short-term rentals and they had to go to a hotel, are we collecting the fees that we should be collecting from these short-term rentals? Do you have the staff to make sure that we are collecting what we need to collect?
Fortunately, Mr. Riddick, this is one of those areas where it's not our staff that has to go out and collect. The people remit directly to the through the commissioner revenue and remit to the treasurer on whatever the schedule is that they set up. You know, hotels are remitting monthly. Some of these are remitting quarterly, but the remits are going directly to the commissioner. And with a change in state law, they're soon going to come directly from the, you know, those who use VRBO and use Airbnb and Expedia, those are coming directly from the network platform, whatever it's called, and that's being remitted directly to the city. There are some that don't use those platforms, and they remit to the city as part of their business license.
Do we know whether we are collecting what we should be collecting, or what's being remitted to us is what should be remitted, or is there a gap in, you know, collecting the money?
Unfortunately, I cannot answer that question. The auditing is done by the Commissioner of Revenues, not done by planning. We're not getting from the ones that are not registered with us and don't use those, you know, main platforms. We know we're not getting from them. You know, it's all a matter of, you know, do we know we're getting the meals tax that we're supposed to get from restaurants? You know, they self-report and pay the tax.
So we put a moratorium on these short-term rentals until we can catch up. Is that possible? Who would make that decision?
We are in a better position now than we've ever been because of state law that requires intermediaries as of October 1st to transmit directly those taxes. The problem is they don't necessarily transmit the taxes specific to a parcel, but they do it in bulk. So that is a bit of the challenge. And I've talked with the Commissioner of Revenue in the Treasurer's Office. What I'd like to know is how much money we're actually getting from these as a because I think we're getting a significant amount of money from these taxes. The bigger issue is whether or not, George, you and your department have enough enforcement staff to actually ensure that they're registered and that they're complying. And I think because we now have provided additional staff, hopefully after hours, et cetera, that we're able to better enforce. Because, I mean, I know Tommy and I, that's one of the things that we hear is, you know, the after hours actions. Do we have the zoning? That is the issue that I'm concerned about, is the enforcement piece.
The other issue with this too is that, I don't want to say it's not a policy, I don't want to get into that discussion, but we have people who are operating these illegally. We catch them, we tell them to go through the process for approval, maybe because they didn't know they had to apply. Some I believe they did know they were supposed to apply. And then we have others who, because we have a process where you can apply for these, we make them go through this process, and then they get to us, and we say no. So this is the conversation that Adam had up at VML about, do you allow them to happen, and then you regulate the ones that are legal, and you're collecting money off of them, or do you just now all of a sudden decide that you just deny every single one of them, and guess what? They're going to still operate illegally, and we have no control over them. And this is the debate that we're having in East Oceanview as well, because we're seeing a lot more in East Oceanview than in Willoughby. Willoughby has a fair share of these, probably mostly illegal. And you have a civic league down in Willoughby who's very opposed to these. And I don't think they've ever supported one, Martin. You have to tell me. Is this the first one they've opposed? Generally, I've always heard Willoughby's opposed to them, so I don't, and I know on Facebook they are. I don't know where we go with this, Paul. It's like, you know, you want people to comply. I mean, how many are coming before us, George, in the next couple of months? There's like 40. There was, if you look at the future planning, you won't be here, Paul, so it won't matter. But it's like 40 to 60 of these, I think I counted, that are coming before us, and you know, is it going to stop? I don't know. Do we just start denying them if they're going to operate, and we don't have the staff to enforce them if they're then operating illegally? So it's kind of this catch, you know, with us on it.
Two questions, and this is to piggyback off of the point that Tommy's making. Have we defined what the percentage is for saturation regarding SDRs? And the second is, I heard in your intro regarding this property, she's going to be moving to Washington State. Did she explain or provide who is going to be managing the property while she's on the West Coast to ensure she's in compliance with everything she's stating that she's promising that will be upheld and upkept on this property?
She does have a property manager under contract to manage the property. I don't know. I don't have the name of that. I believe that may be the person that will be coming to council tonight. In answer to the question of have we defined a saturation point, no, we have not defined a saturation point. You know, there have been, you know, lots of numbers that are thrown out, and none of them seem to stick up against a wall, but, you know, it's, you know, right now, wherever we are, and we start doing we start doing these kinds of analyses using, you know, of these spatial analysis, and it's a really low percentage. I mean, it's a single-digit percentage of the residential units that are being used as short-term rental. So hard to say that that's a saturation point. I mean, I understand the neighborhood saying a bright line of one, that zero and there's a big difference between zero and one. Problem is there's already one in there that's getting ready to be approved because it can be approved administratively. It doesn't require a conditional use permit.
Yes, Mr. Thomas. The best I can tell look
at this on a case-by-case basis and say, is this something that's going to benefit the neighborhood, or is it something that might not benefit the neighborhood? In this particular circumstance, you have a large single-family home surrounded very close, within 10 feet in every direction of another single-family home. Not an ideal situation to have someone renting week by week and potentially partying and waking neighbors up when they're getting up to try to go to work at 7 in the morning. Does allowing a short-term rental at this exact location, does it help that neighborhood? Clearly, according to the neighbors, it doesn't. And objectively, I don't see how it does. But, Tommy, you and I have seen some apartment buildings that were dilapidated, drug dens that have been bought up and redeveloped, and certainly does help the neighborhood when they're renovated and turned into short-term rentals. So I think we have to continue to look at each one case by case. It's going to be a call.
Yeah, this one, within 1 mile, according to, and I appreciate you guys are putting that on there, is 3.2%, because there's 25 of these within a mile. That's the highest that I've seen, I think, on any of these that have come before us, even compared to East Ocean View. I don't know, can we just make all these administratively? Do they all have to come before planning and council?
I'm afraid so.
That was our policy, though, wasn't it? Wasn't that the short-term rental 2.0?
I'm not aware of that.
We're the ones who determine that if it's four or more units, then it comes before planning and council. Is that correct, George?
Absolutely, sir.
Yeah. So we can change that and make it all administratively, and George's staff can deal with it.
You know, if it starts getting automated, collecting the revenue, that might not be a bad solution at some point.
What you can do to make it administrative is to change the zoning by right. You can't delegate this council's discretion for a land use in any particular case.
I also think we're just way too early in the short-term rental sort of cycle of life for us to just swap it and say we're either going to do them all or we're not going to do them at all. It's way too early. We don't know the sophistication or the maturity of this industry yet. And so I think the way we're doing it is the best way at this moment in time. But I do think we need to keep our eye on the ball.
There might be some people speaking tonight about this, but I have one civic league that's choosing not to hear these at all. They're done with them. And so they've now put it on the owners to do their own public hearing, basically. And now one of these, they're doing it via Zoom. So they're not even scheduling it at a public place where people come to talk about it. They literally are holding it on Zoom. Some people will argue that's a good thing because more people will have access technically to it than going to a restaurant or whatever, or a library. And then others will argue that that's wrong because you can exclude people, you know, from it. So every time these come up, we get new things. We're dealing now with brand new houses being built and people are buying them for short-term rentals, a $600,000 house, which I have an issue with that. It wasn't a family that was living in it, owned it, and now wants to turn it into a small business. They're literally buying up brand new houses.
Which is a good reason why it shouldn't be administrative and that we make the decision.
Yeah.
So
right.
I'm turning it back on you.
Yeah. Well, we could also put a policy in place that says no new houses, you know, give that direction to staff, so.
Are you having fun, George?
All right, the next one is one that I thought we were going to spend a lot of time talking about. Slow Dive Gallery at 117 East Princess Anne. This is the one where the conditional use permit had expired, and they asked for a renewal. However, as of last Friday, they have withdrawn their application and are shuttering that business.
That has come up as a result of this application, and it's not Slow Dive. It's not on the agenda, but it's come to my attention, and I have a concern with how we address taxes. And are we being consistent with every CUP that comes up? Is there a review of delinquency in advance before it even gets to the Planning Commission? And is there a delinquency report that comes from the Commissioner of Revenue's office to city staff? Because I think we have to be across the board. Every CUP has to be treated the same way. And I'm worried it's come across as we are targeting certain businesses. Can you? And is there an opportunity maybe for a working group between the Commissioner of Revenues, the Treasurer's Office, Planning, the attorneys, how we're addressing this? Because I've heard a lot of conflicting issues here, but I didn't hear anything about taxes in advance of the Planning Commission's unanimous vote, and then there was an issue about taxes a couple weeks later. So that should have happened before anything ever, the application even happened. Can we talk about that?
So, George, before we do that, this has been withdrawn, right?
Yes, sir.
So the motion upstairs.
We're not voting on it.
So it's been withdrawn. So, Mr. McClellan, clarity, are you discussing this particular item or something
no,
else?
No, but because of this item, it has arisen.
All right, so let's be careful. This item was not proper before it's withdrawn.
So
let's talk generally.
Generally, I am asking the question about how we address taxes for CUPs that are either new CUPs because we've made a change in the zoning text amendment and we're requiring them to go through that for entertainment and alcohol, or for new applications. Do we have a consistent policy to look at taxes?
The answer is, I know it's not
a land use issue, but
we absolutely look at the issue of real estate taxes. And business the B-poll tax, those we clearly are able to look at. The information that you got late, that everybody got late, was because the city attorney's office prevailed upon the ABC folks to share with us the reports that had been submitted to ABC, and then they were able to work them backwards against the receipts that had occurred. Or in this case, not been made to the Commissioner of Revenue.
So, is that a consistent? I mean, isn't there a reason why we can't be? We have to do this consistently. And why did that come up after the Planning Commission?
I would say it's a good observation. We've only recently started doing this on new applications and on businesses where we've had recurring complaints. As we've stood up the business compliance unit. So 6 months ago, we would not have had the staff on hand to pay any particular attention. So I do like the idea of putting together a work group of establishing what is the, what are all of the pre-application documents and conditions that we need to see before sending the application to Planning Commission, agreeing internally what those things should be, whether it's people, real estate, meals tax, et cetera, and then consistently apply that to all applications going forward. I have had that recommendation from Ms. Royal and some other council members, so we can meet internally, put that together, and start to apply that consistently.
And make sure that it's communicated to these businesses in advance on our website, et cetera, that this is the expectation, et cetera, and that, you know, I worry that we've been selective here. There's an appearance of that, and I just want to make sure that is not the case and that we have a consistent policy.
And I think it's more so a function. Council was very generous in giving the planning department 8 new staff to focus on these types of issues this year. We've recently gotten staffed up, so we do have the ability to look at things a lot closer. To your point, we'll do so.
George?
Now I realize that Dr. Perry and Mel have fully briefed you guys on this project. This is the next part of St. Paul's. I just wanted to bring to your attention that this will be coming up in December, and it's a votorama. You will be making a lot of votes on this one. So it's 8 separate votes. The first will be for the rezoning of the area bounded in red to the St. Paul's, the downtown St. Paul's district. And then there'll be 7 different blocks you'll vote on individually to approve the conditional use permits for the specific development that's going to take place in each of those blocks. Mr. Riddick, this is where the lower density, lower impact units are beginning to occur. And thank you for pushing us to make sure that this got up and got, and I'm happy that you'll be able to vote on it before you retire.
Thank you, sir.
The next item is Kyor. It's a CUP for nightclub, and this will also be, I believe, on the 13th agenda. This is an existing nightclub that is. Their CUP expired, and they are applying for a renewal. This is what it looks like. Although those graphics in the windows have been removed because they were they actually diminished the amount of transparency below that which is required by the zoning ordinance. Currently, it's all papered over because since the CUP expired, they've taken this opportunity to do a lot of interior renovations on the site. Essentially what is being proposed is less intense than the current operation. So they are proposing now 10 a.m. to 12 a.m. 7 days a week, with 90 seats indoors, 40 outdoors, and 139 total capacity, which is precisely the same that they had in their previous CUP, with the precisely the same entertainment options. This was an application that was amended at the Planning Commission public hearing by the applicant and their attorney to reduce the hours of operation to a closing at midnight 7 days a week. You all have been asking for this kind of spatial analysis. So there are 8 restaurants within 1,000 feet. 3 don't have entertainment. 4 have entertainment but no DJs. And 1 is a nightclub with a DJ. I believe that's Baxter's. All 7 or 7 of the 8 restaurants operate with extended hours. They've had their issues. They had an overcapacity problem once in 2021. There were 9 calls for service, but the applicant was able to refute most of those at the public hearing. Indicating that many of them apparently are coming from the adjacent public parking lot. There were 3 zoning violations, 2 of which were corrected, and then the 3rd was a clarification that we needed, so none of those are current violations. And as for those 9 calls for service, 1 was for assault, 2 were for person with weapon, 1 was for a disturbance, 2 was for a crowd, and 3 calls were for investigations, whatever that means. Pardon?
But you're saying those were in that parking lot, or were they inside the establishment?
They were, to the best of our knowledge, we cannot document that they were inside the establishment. And so we take the applicant at his word that the parking lot is where the calls for service are coming from.
Can I ask you one question on that? Go ahead, George, finish the whole.
All right, Planning Commission on a 3-2 vote recommends approval. With the closing hours reduced to midnight and a two-year expiration date. We had had this concern about the ownership and how it was all structured and whatever. That was, in fact, clarified to everyone's satisfaction. And so the applicant agreed to the conditions, and as a consequence, the Planning Commission recommended approval, although there were two members of the commission who were still concerned about the fragility of the area and you know, the kinds of uses that are leading to some bad behavior, but that's the. So, you had a question.
So, their lawyer at the Planning Commission refuted the night calls for service. Many people can refute calls for service. It doesn't mean it's so. And if I'm not mistaken, then the police bus was parked in that parking lot for several weeks, if I'm not mistaken, as a deterring effect because of the activity that took place near that establishment. So I just want to make people aware of the situation that has taken place regarding the calls for service, the police bus, and you talked about the ownership issues. And those were resolved within hours, I believe, of your Planning Commission taking their vote. And so that timeliness of that information was interesting as well. So I just leave it at that.
Okay, Ms. Royster.
I have a question for you, George. So in referencing the incidences, the applicant at that, well, we said the applicant, but the owner of that time is not the same applicant at application. Because I've heard about this, and is that where the discrepancy was in the hearing, that we thought that this was a continuation where the original person was one who was applying, but this is actually a separate entity?
That's correct.
And so the pause for service was when it was under another applicant or owner during that period of time? Or was it the current person who's applying?
The calls for service that were identified were since the current ownership structure has been in place. So this does not go back beyond back to the previous owner and previous operator. This is the current owner and operator. Staff, I'm told that my staff did reach back out to NPD to try to verify this, and the police couldn't identify one way or the other whether it was an inside or outside, and you know, they put an address on it, but the report did not indicate inside or outside.
Okay,
Mr.
Thomas.
George, the zoning violation in June of 22, it says transparency issues. Was that the decal on the window that you were referencing?
Yes, sir.
Every time I went by there, they always had curtains closed so you couldn't see in or out as well. That was very concerning. Was that ever addressed?
We addressed that. and made it very clear to the owner that the curtains have to go, and he has assured us that as part of the interior renovations, there won't be any curtains once they finish that remodel.
A lot of violations. Okay. Thanks.
And George, did the issue of the police bus ever, was that ever shared with people that the police stationed their bus in that parking lot across the street purposefully?
No.
Thank you.
Okay.
I think I get to sit down. I hope.
I have a question.
Yes.
Sorry, George. Has the planning department been at all involved with the possibility for what's going to happen at the Maury High School site? I know we had been involved with it when we had the elementary schools. I recall being on the planning commission at the time. We got some information. Have we gotten any information about that?
Both our historic preservation officer and the chair of the city planning commission have reached out to the school administration with a request to to talk about, try to figure out what it is, and whether there are options that are being considered that aren't being reported in the newspaper.
So, Mr. Mayor, we all received a unsolicited bid about the possibility of preserving the Maury site with adaptive reuse and building a new Maury. Is it the school board's responsibility to determine what happens to Maury once they depart Maury, or is it the city's?
If we're going to do council concerns, I think we better, if you want to talk to George about that, or
school board.
The manager just told me that it is the city's, it will be the city's building.
If the PPA comes in,
we'll still be using it for some school use.
It's a collaboration between the city and the school board. The school board ultimately makes the final decision on what happens to that building. Right now, they have the decision of that.
Has there been any collaboration? Because I don't know of any.
But I will tell you, I disagree with people saying that there wasn't public meetings. There was, and it was advertised on Norfolk's website. People were asleep. I hate to say that. Some of your civic leagues were asleep.
No, civic leagues weren't contacted.
It was public knowledge about it, and so until the school board
answered this,
I was only asking specific to the planning department.
I should have been paying attention. So
this is the whole conversation.
Sorry.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sure it's just a
It is the school board. School board size.
Thank you, Mayor. This next presentation is very lengthy, but it's all very timely and good information for council and also folks in the neighborhoods. We thought this would be a good time to provide a very lengthy but comprehensive update on where we are in the implementation of council's current capital plan, which you adopted earlier this year as a component of the FY23 operating capital budget. You will recall that this is probably the biggest, most comprehensive capital plan that you have authorized in recent memory. That's in part due to the infusion of federal dollars, but also an intense focus on neighborhood quality of life. So we will not have time to get into all of the CIP this evening, but we wanted to touch on the projects that are primarily managed by the Public Works Department. They provide a lot of internal service to other agencies, such as Parks and Rec and other departments. You'll see the work divided up in the design division as well as the stormwater division in this presentation. If we're going to try and walk through this very briskly, if you want some more information on specific projects, we may just mention them. If you want follow-up information, let us know. If you don't see a project that you're interested in, let us know, because we have staff here that can answer those. Also excluded from the presentation, we're not talking about municipal water and sewer. Those are managed by the utility enterprise. And then following this presentation, John Stevenson has an update on one transportation project. So if you, while we're not getting into the transportation component, John's here if you do have questions about that. So I think I just spent more time telling you what's not in the presentation, but it is lengthy at that. So Richard, for all that, Director of Public Works, will get us started and introduce his staff.
Good evening, Mayor Alexander, members of council. Because of the length of this, I'm going to jump right into it. So we're going to have two parts of this. Chuck Joyner, Assistant City Engineer, is going to do all the projects that are non-stormwater. So he's going to lead off, and he's going to be followed up with John White, who would do all the stormwater projects. Chuck?
Thank you, Richard. Good evening, everyone. And I'm the guy that is making it lengthy. I was told to kind of shorten what I'm. So I'm going to try to be as brisk as I possibly can. With what we're doing, but be also comprehensive as well. So as we mentioned, there are two parts of the presentation. The first is the design division, and the second is the stormwater division. I'm going to lead off with that, and then John is going to follow me. I think we kind of divided it into a number of different divisions for both the design. We're going to cover the ARPA projects, some of the major public works projects, bridges, our dredging program, and also some additional projects in case anyone has any questions on those. And then John will be following up with categories that the stormwater projects fall into. Design division, as was mentioned previously, we do provide all the construction services for the entire city with the exception of water and sewer services. And so we will provide services to other departments, including Parks and Rec, principally. And that's most of the projects that we're going to talk about this evening have to do with that, in addition to our bridge program and some of our operational things. So the first projects we want to talk about are the ARPA projects. We want to make sure that these get going smoothly. These are two projects for which we are working with Parks and Rec to construct the public boat ramp on Pretty Lake, which is $3 million for that in FY23. We have solicited for designers for that. We've received their responses, and we're in the process of interviewing those so that we can award a contract and start the design on that to implement some concepts that were developed by Parks and Rec a number of years ago when they looked at numerous sites in Ocean View for a boat ramp. The second part of that is also the construct a wooden fishing pier at Granby Street. When we started doing the Granby Street Bridge project, we found that one of the things the community missed more than anything else was when we had to close down access to the fishing platform under the bridge. And so this is construction of a walkway about 300 feet out to about a 200-foot pier. I think I got those figures right. A wooden pier that would allow the community to once again engage in that activity. And that that is something where we are in the process of selecting a consultant for that as well. The improved 23rd Street streetscapes, this is a phase project, that we're going to be engaging in. This is essentially bumping the commercial development of the corridor that we have, 21st Street, 22nd Street, north of the railroad track, so that we kind of push that that development up to the north. The first part of that is $1.8 million in stormwater funding, and that is, $3 million in FY23. Most of that is going to be for stormwater. That's going to be our first effort. So we should be getting to construction sometime late next year with that. The Greeny site, this is the improvement of the former Greeny site. There was $1.5 million appropriated in FY23 for the phase one improvements. We're working through that. Design is underway. And we are working to allow for a future development, which would include a phase two. Phase one is green space, additional parking, extending that Ocean View Beach Park over across the site, and also extending that promenade. We had a protective dune that we were able to construct with the VPA beach nourishment project. We were able to get that in place, so that's a big expense that we were able to do with that project rather than having to take money from the Greeny site project as well. Then we have a number of park sites. Improved Huntersville Park site. This is $700,000 that was appropriated in FY23. We've held numerous meetings with the community. We're in the process of finalizing that scope when that exercise is through. We're looking to go to construction sometime in mid-23 because we have on board park contractors for design and for construction that we can utilize for that and get that going very quickly. The also other two projects, Broad Park, Transform Broad Park in FY23. We have received we sent out a request for a proposal for designers. We've gotten the responses back on those, and we are in the process of making a selection for those. Also, Northside Park, this we have also solicited for a design consultant on that. We've got the responses back, and we'll be making a design selection this month. So we can move ahead with transforming both of those two park communities.
Three of the park projects, I hope the city manager's office is considering video surveillance being installed at all three parks while we have this opportunity, while we're renovating them, that there is, I know it's not going to be perfect, but we should have that installed at parks. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
And LED lights.
Yeah, so
that
is needed to replace every.
So, there are some additional ARPA projects that were mentioned, and I provided a slide here just kind of outlining what the purpose of those were and what the appropriations were. And we'll be happy to answer any questions that later if we need to.
on those projects as well. Some of the other projects, major public works projects, $4.5 million in FY23. This is our street infrastructure. This is going to be used for resurfacing principally. We have $1.5 million that is programmed for Berkeley, about $500,000 that is programmed for Campostella, and then a couple on the eastern side and on Newtown Road in the Woodbine area and Spartan Village, those are our targeted areas for resurfacing with this program.
Just really quickly, this number does not include the $6 million that we're going to be putting towards the Campostella Bridge.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
And that's going to be resurfaced as well.
There will be a new deck on that, a new concrete topping on that. We'll be redoing that deck.
Thank you for the clarity.
Okay, sure. And finally, this is another one of our projects, the improved neighborhood streets. And this is a small appropriation, $550,000, but this is what reaches out to people in the neighborhoods when they see their sidewalk, their curb and gutter getting replaced. And so we've allocated funding in this project to Berkeley neighborhood, to Huntersville, to Lake Taylor. And then there are other small projects where our streets and bridges folks keep a list of things that need to be repaired. And once we get through that, if there are funds remaining, we will look to make some improvements in Ballantyne Place and also in Crown Point area. The Neon District, this is a cooperative venture between the Department of Transit, the folks from Utilities, and Public Works. The overall budget probably $7-8 million. That's kind of an estimate at this point. But $1.8 million is appropriated in stormwater improvements for the area in FY23. So what we're doing is we're doing stormwater, we're doing water and sewer, and we're doing the streetscaping all in one package. We're in the process of trying to scope and get that designed and into one package so that we only tear up the street once. And one of the things that we want to make sure that we do is to partner with the DNC and the local businesses there. That's going to be a critical element of this. We want to ensure that we minimize the disturbance to those businesses in place during the construction process, which we think will start sometime in late 2023. And our bridge program, there are 53 bridges that we have in the city of Norfolk. This is the latest new bridge that we actually constructed. It's the Shore Drive Bridge back in 2003. So it's 20 years old. It needs a little bit of work here. And so $1.5 million was appropriated in the budget last year. We are in the process of scoping, identifying where the cracks are, where the bearings are that we're going to replace, all of those sorts of things. That's in the process with our design consultant. And we intend to go to construction on that in late 2023. The other parts of our bridge program, we were very, very pleased that we were able to get an appropriation of $3 million in our bridge program last year in FY23. That's an increase. And so we have appropriated that to the following projects that you see listed. We're now in the process of doing the Hampton Boulevard northbound bridge. Those are with FY22 and previous funds. However, with this, since the contractor is in place, we also want to make some repairs that we need to do on the south side or the southbound span, and so we're moving to we'll do that as well. There's some other projects that are included in here as well. I wanted to point out the citywide bridge preservation program, and that's a program where we recognize that we can't fix all of the bridge issues in the city. They're too many, too vast. But what we can do is we can extend the service life of the structure. And we do that by identifying areas on the deck where the water seeps through, mixes with the road salt, seeps into the concrete, and damages the bearings, the substructure, the structure of the superstructure of the bridge. So what we essentially do is we buy some time. We extend the life of the bridge so that we don't have to come in and do major repairs, which are much more expensive, but we can prevent that. Think about it as keeping the roof on your house as in really good condition. So that's a very, very important program, and we'll be identifying a number of bridges that we'll be applying this program to. And finally, there are the bridge inspections. We do our bridge inspections in-house. However, the larger bridges, Hampton Boulevard, Grammy Street, Campostella, we do hire consultants to do that. They have the snooper equipment, and they do that for us. Those are federally mandated inspections. All of our bridges have to be inspected every 2 years as a federal mandate, and this allows us to make that happen on the larger bridges where we don't have the equipment to necessarily do that. Finally, two bridges that are not in good condition. The Springfield Avenue Bridge, we finally funded for that last year. We really appreciate that. $350,000 for the demolition of that bridge. It's been closed for probably 15 years, I think, or more maybe. That will finally be removing that blight on that community there. That we're going to use the standing demolition contracts that the Department of Neighborhoods maintains to do that. And so we actually plan in December, we should be getting that project ready for bid with them. And we, sometime in mid-2023, we're going to try to beat that. But that's our schedule at this point in starting the demolition of that bridge. Also related to that is the Crown Point Bridge, an old pedestrian bridge, which is no longer used, no longer needed, and that will be demolished as part of that same program, the same effort. Dredging program, this is always one that we have, the residential dredging program, $150,000 in FY23. We're going to use that to clear up some, to do some maintenance dredging in the Haven Creek area, particularly by the boat ramp where we have some issues and we need to keep that clear so that recreational boaters and people using that boat ramp will have clear access. We also, while we have a dredger in place, we use that as an opportunity to bring our stormwater folks and clear the outfalls adjacent to the waterway. Since the dredger's there, it's an efficient way to get that done. The design of that is underway. We're waiting the permit for that from the Corps of Engineers, and we anticipate that sometime in the middle of next year we'll be able to go to construction on that issue. And so there's some other CIP projects that I've listed, and as we mentioned before, if there are any questions, we'll be happy to take a look at those or to provide answers or updates on any of those at now or at a later date. And that was the end of the design projects, and if I could now turn over to John for the stormwater project.
I'm going to let Kimberly do our flipping here. We have a pretty extensive CIP this year. We really, really appreciate the opportunity. But this is, if you recall, this plan was given to you a few years back, and we're up in the process of updating that. So we'll be getting that out first of the year sometime. And then, but we had four neighborhoods, actually five, counting St. Paul's. But the four neighborhoods are the Glenwood Park. You don't want to try the, we have a neat feature here. Or just click on one of them. Yeah, there we go. This is that small neighborhood off Hampton Boulevard. And we're basically working closely with the Navy on permitting the outfall. All the flow comes from Hampton Boulevard through this neighborhood and out to the Willoughby Bay. So we're looking, designing this. We should have a first phase out probably in second quarter of 23, but there's a lot of red tape on this one. And then this is Coleman Place. We have, that's an older neighborhood, probably predates the city. Yeah, it's definitely neglected. It has some serious stormwater issues. We're going to upgrade the trunk lines and get that up. We should have a phase probably first quarter of 23.
For Coleman Place, is that including near the slope where
you're
going to do?
That would. That's one of the longest sections of that. There's water pipes that start there and go all the way to Robinson Road, and so that is part of the upgrade that we'll see.
Yeah, because when it rains, doing slope. Teachers, nobody can get out.
Yeah. Just some inside information. When you're upgrading stormwater, you start at the outfall and then work out because that way it you get the direct benefit right away.
And I like how you're connecting it to when you talk about
Robinwood. Yeah, that's an issue. We made some major repairs there and it definitely needs some TLC for sure.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. And East Ocean View, this is a multi-phase effort. We're going to put stormwater drainage down most of the streets, almost every other street, and then Pleasant Avenue will get curb cutter sidewalk along there. So, and then this is Glen Rock. I don't think it's quite, well, anyway, that's Military Circle in green, and most of that water from Janiff crosses Virginia Beach Boulevard through Military Circle into Glen Rock. And so we're looking forward to working with the developer on Military Circle to kind of reduce the effects of on Glen Rock. So, and next slide, please. Coastal adaptation, this is kind of a related tangentially to Kyle Spencer's work, but this neighborhood, Carroll Cambridge, part of Larchmont, really gets unbelievable flooding constantly, and we were funded in 23 to fix this. It's under construction. They've made repairs to the berm and got that mostly done. They're now working on the retaining wall. Now they're working on the berm, and should finish up before the second quarter of 23. And then the next one is Lake Herbert. That's over by Broad Creek area, next to the Social Security. The dam failed and drained Lake Herbert, and we're putting in a new weir structure and dam. And well, what we're going to do is set this up so that we can potentially lower the water levels, you know, by dropping the weir. And that way we can empty water in advance of a major hurricane or precipitation event. Here's two street projects. The bottom one, we just advertised Freeman Avenue. Bids came a little high, but nothing terrible. This is right behind Janiff. There's some apartment buildings, and it drains out through Kempsville. The one on top, we're still working through a nationwide environmental permit. And this is that industrial area, little industrial park behind Broad Creek Shopping Center. And then here's some water quality projects here. Really leveraging a lot of grant funds for our water quality effort. Lake Whitehurst, we're working closely with utility department and retrofitting a lot of those little fingers enhance the drainage. We're cleaning those up, getting them ready. And then we also have a DCR grant to do a complete hydrologic and hydraulic modeling of Lake Whitehurst and advance of some J-Loose work that's coming. Meadow Lake is in Hopper Hall. It's another retrofit. Again, we have SLAP funding for that project. St. Paul's were funding most of the stormwater piece within the development itself, but our big project is the Blue Greenway. We're trying to be as innovative and creative. We're limiting the project to stormwater, but also the connectivity. Chuck will get a new bridge out of this. We're going to have Freemason Street Bridge that will be added during the second phase of the road work. So, and this is our old gray infrastructure. A lot of it's getting aged. Hampton Boulevard and Monticello, we have some issues with underdrain systems, and we're going to try to fix those. You can see the moisture coming through the retaining walls on both sides. So hopefully we'll get that squared away. Chesapeake Boulevard outfall in Ocean View, we've been going through a lot of permit efforts, but we're close to advertising that project now. So, and here's some additional stormwater projects. A lot of these are some of the funding sources from stuff you've seen earlier. But if you have any questions or concerns, happy to hear from you.
Thank you so much. All right, Ms. Doyle.
I just want to say, Chuck and John, you do a fabulous job. Thank you for coming forward today and presenting all the work that you're doing. And I'll tell you, Richard, when they present to the community and get feedback from civic leads, they really listen. Chuck and John, you do, and you have responded so well. And I just want to say thank you and appreciate the work that you do.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. And yes, Mr. Smigel, do you have contractors? My big concern with all these projects is, are there people working to do this? I know it's tight because with all the federal money that's going around the country, a lot of these contractors are getting sucked up. But I know we have some, you know, long term. But
there's some local outfits.
I think there is an issue about capacity. And maybe we're approaching hitting limits on that. We've talked about it on the design vision and ourselves and the utility department also. It's a challenge, but I think it would give these contractors an opportunity to expand or maybe bring in a new guy.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Roberts.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Closely related, we have one project that I'm going to invite John Stevenson, Director of Transit, come to the podium and discuss, and that is the upgrade of the street lighting system all across the city, LED replacement project. John, take a look.
All right, thank you. Trying to do this quickly for you. Thank you very much, Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council. Pleased to be before you tonight to give you a quick update, hopefully, on the progress. So, we acquired the services and all of a consultant to help us with this particular project. They've really been on board and working since mid-August with the goal of producing up to 1,000 streetlight conversions per month. So that's our goal, and it's a commitment that Dominion Power has made as well. So the progress. So for right now, Dominion Energy provided all of their GIS data to us and our consultants, and our consultants have gone through that data, done some spot checks to do some quality control and verify the information that's been provided to us. That task has been completed. They've also undertaken a program to evaluate the street network to determine where we have arterial streets, local streets. The priority of the lighting levels is dictated by width of the street, the spacing of the street light poles between each other, along with some of the other priorities that they've included in this, which is taking a look at pedestrian activity areas. The more pedestrian activity you have, the higher illumination levels that you like to have. They've also almost completed an analysis of the Dominion Energy fixtures that they recommend we replace our existing fixtures with. We've asked that this task be done because over the past couple of years, we've done some smaller projects that, quite frankly, we weren't pleased with the end results. And so as a result of that, we asked for this particular effort to be undertaken to make sure that we, as we move forward, we're using the correct fixtures to provide the appropriate lighting levels that are needed for the various parts of the city. They've also done an update to the analysis that Civic Labs provided for us, back in, probably, I think, June of this year. And they've completed an analysis of that. They've tweaked some of the measures that are being used, along with some of these other measures that I just previously mentioned, to update that. This is an example of one of the typical roadway sections that they've taken a look at. So they look at, again, the width of the roadway, how wide is the median, what's the spacing of the poles. They've actually come up with 24 different typical sections that will help them to determine the appropriate lighting levels. This is a partial of the map that they produce showing pedestrian activity. The red areas are those with a higher pedestrian activity. The yellow is moderate to medium, and green represents low pedestrian activity. So all this is very important as we move forward in determining the lighting levels that we place on our roadways. This is, again, the Civic Lab product that is, again, being fine-tuned. This is going to be placed ultimately on our website so that citizens will be able to track and understand where their neighborhoods may lie in the program. Off on the left-hand side, this is a sort of an old slide where we have the month 1 through 28. Well, you know, obviously we're going to update that to include March of 23, April of 23 to help better enable residents to understand when they might expect street light upgrades to occur. Our next steps are really complete that analysis of the streetlight fixtures that are being offered by Dominion Energy, fine-tune the analysis to make sure that we're looking at all those measures and parameters to provide the correct lighting levels for our citizens. And we're now waiting on the consultant to submit their draft prioritization of projects. I just heard today that based on where we are with the schedule, they are actually hoping to start submitting projects to Dominion Energy by January. So I think that's really good news. It's taken us a while to get to this point, but there's been a lot of effort that's gone into really taking the opportunity not just to do streetlight conversions, but to really take a look at our neighborhoods and provide adequate lighting levels. Once the program really starts to roll out, we'll be certainly working with our partners in neighborhood services to advise residents and civic leagues when they might expect their neighborhoods to be converted to LED, taking a look at doing social media outreach. We've partnered very well with communications on that aspect. And then again, you will be placing this analysis tool on our webpage for residents to be able to view and determine what when they can again expect to see the lighting upgrades. Because of this advanced effort, we haven't been sitting back and doing nothing with the LED program for the conversions. We had a number of projects that we had in the pipeline, so to speak, that we wanted to get to Dominion Energy, so we've been doing that. We've had, for an example, we've submitted Lafayette Boulevard from Lafayette River Bridge to Tidewater Drive. Sections of Tidewater Drive, particularly in the area of where the Northside Park is, where we had a child struck just about a year and a half ago, and I guess now. Another high crash area, Roland Park Overpass area. So from Willowood, from Norview Avenue up to Willowood? Willowood? Not Willowood.
Widgeon.
Yes, thank you. To Widgeon, thank you. Has been submitted. We've done a small project at Evelyn T. Butts HRT transfer station to improve the lighting in that area. And that's just an example of some of the areas that we are being sort of proactive on. Questions? Try to do that quickly.
Okay, Ms. Johnson.
Okay, I'm so excited about this. One. Two, in the future, as we consider EV charging, I hope we're also thinking about these light poles and EV charging, because we're going to have to do that, because not everybody's got that. So I'm just going to put it in there, and I know the manager's looking at it, so we got to be thinking about how people charge their cars in the streets. And
that's a great concept, because the infrastructure, you know, how are we going to build out that infrastructure? And I think that's a perfect example of thinking outside the box.
Ms. Johnson.
How are you?
Good evening. How are you?
Good. So you have a database for the pole replacement and upgrade. So the consulting team went through the city to look at the different types of poles, because some of them are leaning, some of them need to be replaced, some of them have poles beside the pole. So that's why I'm asking about
that. Really isn't being addressed. I mean, as we go out and make field notes. I think we're noting that. We're noting, for example, locations where there used to be a street light. The pole was replaced and the street light wasn't replaced back in. But, you know, this program is strictly for the conversion of existing street lights to LEDs.
Okay. Good. Glad to hear that.
For the pedestrian activity, I saw the yellow and the red on, but online, can you actually see it by ward?
At
least on the way it is right now.
We can absolutely insert the ward
okay.
lines.
That will help our citizens,
okay.
especially in reference to where they live when they look at the map.
All right. Good idea.
And then the last thing, I know that there were two top priorities that the council had for light replacement. One was taking a look at the major thoroughways in our city, such as a Tidewater Drive, those
right.
long, most traveled streets. How are we doing with identifying those fairways?
So that's part of what I had said, that you know, we are actually doing in-house for certain sections. We're not going to do all of Tidewater Drive, but we have areas where we've identified where there are high crash rates, where pedestrians or cyclists have been struck, injured, or even fatalities. So those are the areas that actually we've been internally working on very very closely with Dominion Energy.
Okay, so you're not going to do all of Tidewater Drive?
No, but ultimately... Through this program, we are, yes, we're going to do all the major corridors. The timing-wise, you know, this is part of the challenge, is we need to have identified areas that make it constructible, if you will, from the contractor side. We don't want to have projects spread throughout the city on 1,000 throughout the city. We want to sort of concentrate in certain areas of priority. But... We certainly get that we want to try and not focus too much on one area of the city, but really spread the wealth, if you will.
Well, I'm really interested in how we're spreading the wealth.
That's part of what the oops, wrong way.
That's what I'm talking about, city class.
Correct that within 3.5 years, we would have addressed all the corridors within the city about 3.5 years.
It's looking right now, it's going to be like a 3.5 year program.
Yeah.
At 1,000 per month.
Yeah. So I'm interested, especially with Tyler Drive. That's a long stretch.
Yeah.
And you address Mr. Reddick, then my ward, then Courtney, then he and I have the ward together. So that's a long.
Right.
Stretch with time.
Yeah.
Can
you throw an extra lane in there too while you're in the lights?
Mr. Rick, what's that?
But I do like the point where you're talking about the pedestrian activity,
right.
How active it really is. And lastly, we also set as a priority because of the Norfolk Police Department, that partnership
right.
that we had with them. They identified what was known as hot spots.
Right.
So where is Dominion in addressing the hot spots that MPD, with partnership with us, they identify?
Yeah, that's part of this tool that has that database information in it that our consultant is taking a look at and doing some fine-tuning and tweaking to take a look at those high priority areas, so I have a better way to put it, that I think we need to focus on. Yeah, you know, with 1,000 a month, we'd like to do all the major arterials, but we have to really focus on trying to be really mindful of the needs of the citizens and focusing on these different aspects, high crime areas, and then also on our arterial streets. But at 1,000 a month, it doesn't cover a lot of an area at one time, 1,000 street lights, with over 30,000 lights that need to be converted.
Yeah, but one of the priorities for the council was, again, in partnership with the Norfolk Police Department, because
right.
they're on the street,
right.
and they could tell us exactly where the hot spots were, that we would address those.
Yes,
okay.
absolutely.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Manager. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
John, I think we just need to be realistic and understand the capacity of Dominion to deliver on 1,000 a month? Do they have the material and do they have the labor to deliver on that? Because I think when we tell the community what we're going to do, let's not say 1,000 if we're not going to deliver 1,000. And if it's 500, then it's 500. But we've been telling everybody 1,000, and I'm realistic.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. Our sense is that it's going to take us a little while to build up to potentially doing 1,000 per month. So it's going to take us a couple of months of submitting work orders to Dominion Energy. They've reached out and said, you know, what are the type of fixtures that you're thinking about using, especially on neighborhood streets and on some of the arterials, so they can start thinking about where they're going to acquire those resources from. Because, you know, as we all know, there have been a certain concrete, for example, is just on a short delivery dates are just out there for quite a timeline. Right now, we're not finding that with the number of streetlights that we're putting in the process right now. We're probably doing, I'd say about 200 per month right now, not nearly 1,000. And that's going so-so. It's taking Dominion Energy a little bit of effort to build.
We're not to overpromise and
underdeliver. Yeah. We keep stressing that with Dominion Energy, but they keep saying that they're going to be able to do that. And I guess once we start hitting the... Yeah.
They're hearing our voice as well as yours.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Smigel, did you agree?
I'm done. Yep.
Okay. Two things. Thank you for this presentation and to Councilwoman Johnson. When the first list came out of the neighborhoods, I will tell you it was very balanced around the city of where these were happening, and I noticed that some of our hotspot areas were being addressed early. So I was happy to see that. I don't know, this is more of a PSA, because we don't control this, but the other night I was going down from Ward's Corner to my house, all the way down Little Creek Road to Shore Drive, and I got up to 58 street lights were out on Little Creek Road alone. And so, you know, Demby Park down by Southern Shopping Center, it went through multiple wards again, all down, you know, by Camellia. There were so many lights out that I would love to have somebody hop in the car with me, and I'll drive out at night and get the poll numbers and send them in the Dominion. But I'm just wondering what we can do as a city, because some of those light fixtures will have to be replaced by Dominion because we won't have to pay for it.
Correct.
So getting these street lights in to be repaired right now will help us. But there's a lot out, more than I've ever seen, and you all know, for 12 and a half years I've been on council, I've been the street light hawk.
Yes.
And I remember I used to have access to the program, and I could put them in myself until they took that away. So I don't know how we address it and get them fixed, and your staff is limited, so I don't want you guys out there driving, but how do we...
Yeah.
So Tommy, we did, at Neighborhood League, we did a Light the Night.
Yeah.
Neighborhood services to do, maybe think about doing this citywide, where you basically use our civic leagues to go out and identify poll numbers, and we did block by block, and we had 20 volunteers go out on one night and said, here are all the poll numbers, and submit it to Dominion. And I think our citizens would be happy to do this if we had a coordinated effort and to help market it. You know, we're limited in resources,
right.
Capital, you know, human capital wise. Let's get our folks involved.
I'm sure they still go into Norfolk Cares. Unfortunately, people are still thinking that it's the city's responsibility.
Well, we could easily put together an online reporting system, have it upload to Civic. I think there's an opportunity to do something pretty low tech, but involve our civic leagues.
Getting citizens involved is fairly simple within the community itself. It's a little more challenging when we're asking them to take a look at arterial streets.
This is neighborhoods I'm talking about.
And so I think there's a lot of good reporting on neighborhoods, but not so much on the arterial streets, to the councilman's point. Yeah.
John, anything else?
All right. Thank you.
Mayor, Council, while I have the engineer staff here, I just want to reiterate some points that were made. Now, we also have Keith Arrows here from Transit. We have an incredible engineering team in both Public Works and Transit. That, like I said, if you can envision it, you can fund it, they can deliver it. So we've got an incredible project management delivery team. I just want you guys to work. It's a joy to work with them every day. So thank you for allowing this time. Mayor, we have one additional presentation in open session. That's a commercial corridor update from economic development. Just want to check with you. I know we have a couple items for closed. Do you want to hold that one to be closed and do it if you have time, or what's the pleasure, Council?
Well, I guess I'll ask Sean. Can you present, Sean? How much time do you need, sir?
I allotted 10 minutes, but if I need to shorten that, I can absolutely do so, Mr. Mayor.
7 minutes. Let's go. Question.
Thank you for allowing me to be before you today. I'm excited to talk about this particular program and more than happy to talk with anybody offline regarding some additional details there. Brief overview. I will skip this and just go right to the meat and potatoes on it. And I will skip this slide and go right to this one. So quick overview of the department as a whole. I thought this was important to actually mention because we actually has changed as it relates to a bureau manager system. Just starting from the bottom up, you all know Military Affairs Liaison Len Ramirez. BRE and Workforce is actually now a bureau in itself. Attraction, Business Intelligence, and Marketing is actually forged as one. And then what we'll be talking about today is our new real estate team and addition to our business creation and entrepreneurship team. So this was the traditional team that was doing all things small business. But again, with the merging of the real estate department underneath economic development, and this new strategy really makes sense to actually pull them together as one. Big focus for us, where everybody's aware, there's a new strategic plan that the department is doing as we speak. And in addition to, we are going through some rebranding and marketing to include our website, all things that should hopefully roll out by the end of this particular calendar year. You've seen this slide before by the Department of Human Services, in addition to Aaliyah Slappy-Wilson on the DEI team. But of course, we're looking at the $13 million in that nonprofit assistant bucket out of the $154 million. And we're focusing on the $2 million underneath this particular category that's called business assistance. Research is important. So before we actually got into what a structure of a program could look like, we went back to Plan 2030. It was perfect timing because we actually are in the process of looking at Plan 2050. So again, we were able to really revisit some of those efforts that were solidified in 2013. I had the pleasure of serving on the Mayor's Commission of Social Equity and Economic Opportunity on the economic development side. And so we had a lot of great feedback from the group. One of the big things that I highlighted was real estate assistance, which we'll talk to. Even went back to the old commercial corridor program that I found in 2010, speaking to neighborhood services, in addition to planning department and Paul Lachey, and she actually was able to give me a clip of an old newsletter that went around. Last but not least, I want to make sure I mention this. As it relates to, of course, our partners at the Department of Housing and Community Development, we know that with their focus around vacant lots, there's also integration on commercial corridors as well. So again, we felt that the timing on this particular program was ideal. So what does this program actually mean? These five bullets here really help solidify. We want to invest in neighborhood business districts. Emphasis on the business districts, drive tax revenue, of course, create jobs and a sense of place. Strategically create that sense of place. So again, what is that brand and that vibrancy, right? The identity of that corridor. We want to address the community desire to talk about inclusive economic development opportunities and helping to fill vacancies. What we found in the numbers that in addition to the blight that unfortunately is there, with the pandemic, there's an increase in retail and commercial vacancies. So we want to backfill that effort as well. And then of course, we want to take some of the incentives and programs that we had before and really drive the opportunity to make this program successful. Internal relationships is important. So again, you heard from the DEI team last month, a lot of coordination regarding when do businesses come to us in economic development and when do businesses go to them. They are really in the startup phase nowadays. And so when you look at some of the partners that are already out there, just to name a few, of course, we have ODU, NSU, Black Brand, in addition to 757 Colab. All these organizations are focusing on the startup phase of business. So we didn't think it was necessary for us to reinvent that wheel. We want to focus on businesses who's in that growth phase, hiring experience, retail experience. So when we get them into these corridors, it's a more higher percentage of an opportunity that they will be successful and that they will be sustainable as well. So in terms of the component, we really kind of try to structure it three ways. So that design phase, and when you look at a firm like Petal Retail Advisors, which is one of the firms that we have been in discussion about contracting with, they are there to do a couple of things. So number one, they'll help actually frame the overall application and help answer the question, is this business ready for retail or not? They will also go through with the education side. So back to the Mayor's Commission and Social Equity and Inclusion there, to be able to educate them on how to negotiate that commercial commercial lease, how to navigate that commercial lease, and what does it mean to actually be able to advocate for yourself. When you think about the deploy side, so this is actually the stage that truly involves the community engagement, right? So we need somebody who's gonna have their eyes on engaging with our task force, our civic leads, and our business association to make sure that we hear directly from the community on what the overall vision is. And then the last part would be to administer, of course. I have done this personally for quite some years, administering grants for the city. It is a heavy lift with such a small team. So we wanna bring in some assistance to help us do not just our current programs, which I'll talk to you on the next slide, but the addition of this new commercial corridor program. So again, when I look at this, that's kind of a three-legged stool. We certainly have all the components in place in order to be successful. This slide really speaks to, again, all the areas that some of these contractors will be able to focus on. I highlighted a few on my notes here, but again, that first one, established community and landlord support. You gotta make sure that in order to, of course, make sure that we have some sort of benefit on the commercial corridors and the retail spaces, that the landlords are obviously engaged. Create a database of corridor real estate and tenancy. And so we get a plethora of phone calls that say, hey, I am looking for space, can you help? And so we can actually have a better, more organized catalog of these locations. We can then point those businesses to those corridors that we believe that they will be successful in. Upper right-hand corner, retail real estate education for applicants. So again, some of those traditional or formal classroom settings that just says, here is commercial real estate, here is the lease, here's how you better understand that. Jumping down to the third bullet on the right, commercial retail design support. We understand that there are businesses that have never engaged an architect, right? They've never engaged an engineer. And so what does it mean to navigate through the city process? We want to have assistance there. And then last bullet on the right, of course, continue coordination with community and civic groups. I just can't emphasize enough, this can't be something that just gets done directly with the department. The research that we've done with, if you think of organizations like Main Street Alliance, the State Department of Housing and Community Development, in addition to LISC, all these folks say if the community is not in the driver's seat, that this will not be successful. CAP, I think you all are familiar with. So this particular program is going to return. We're going to reintroduce our micro grants and our reimbursable grants. We're actually going to tweak those a little bit and actually up the dollar amounts. Once again, we realize that dealing with investments in retail is quite expensive, so we want to make sure we account for that. The facade program will be reintroduced, leveraging these dollars as well. Not listed on top of the facades will be monies for interior build-out also. So exterior and interior will be there. And a commercial core or tenant grant, and so we're really tweaking that to say, hey, look, if somebody needs some very intimate hands-on negotiation with a private broker, then that's where a commercial corridor tenant grant can come into play. And I mentioned also leveraging, of course, soft costs for architects and things of that nature will be pulled directly out of that particular bucket. I think I'm doing good on time. Quick chart on what that looks like from a numbers standpoint. So just for distinction, your two top particular buckets there, your micro grant and reimbursable grant, that is our CDBG dollars. And so we still have access to that. Again, we've been working with the budget and the Department of Housing and Community Development to properly make sure we're accounting and reporting for those dollars. So those particular dollar amounts will get us to June 30th, 2023. We're going to apply next month for more CDBG dollars so we can continue the program in 24. And then the last three particular items you see, that commercial corridor grant, facade grant, and the administrative help, that would be directly the $2 million out of the ARPA funds, again, to help out on the overall commercial corridor strategy. So I mentioned this in the beginning, I believe, but again, we want to look at this as a proposal for a pilot. Once again, when we talk to some of the industry experts, they say it's hard to do this well all over the city. You really want to deploy maximum amount of dollars in specific areas so you can see a robust change. And so we want to look at four particular corridors. The first two are actually on your screen here, being 35th Street and Riverview. A couple of reasons why, not on the slide, but these are two areas of historical areas of commerce. They already have established community organizations, such as your civic leads and your task force and business associations. There are some catalytic investments that are happening here. So an example would be 35th Street and the boxing center that is being worked upon with the city and the EDA. The other two areas we would like to look at is Lafayette Boulevard and East Little Creek. Lafayette Boulevard, we also know, does not have an established business association, so they are really starting from the ground up. We also know that there's always been some work with WPA about how do you work with the commercial infill, so we thought it would be a perfect idea to marry our strategy into that. And then East Little Creek, really looking back at that particular community and Plan 2030, very much so an established organization, but they are very interested in learning about what the brand and the vision is going to be. Last thing I'll say is that for these particular communities, in addition to Riverview and 35th Street, it's good because all these communities are at different points on their continuum, as I like to say. And so while Lafayette is actually being built up from the ground up, you have East Little Creek, who's going to be more in a planning phase, and then you have 35th Street and Riverview, which we can actually deploy some businesses into those corridors and see some immediate impacts. Most important thing to realize is that this is pilot. So we want to start here and be able to duplicate these efforts around the city. But in order to start somewhere to prove that this actually works, we thought these four would be the best way to go. Last but not least, on a timeline here, and this is shifting just a bit, but it is very aggressive. And so, again, we're in the month of December, of course, so we want to make sure we got in front of the council first for feedback and our recommendations. But then we want to finalize the program details and bring some of the consultants on board. Again, we've been having conversations for about 3 to 4 months with various groups, and we're ready to make some decisions based on the feedback we get today. We obviously want to go ahead with continued community engagement and then marketing as well. So I've had the opportunity to go to a couple of civic leads and task force informally, but again, I wanted to wait to this presentation and then formally go back out to the community to get their feedback as well. Cooperation agreement with the EDA, we've done this several times before when dollars have flowed on over to the city and over to the EDA to allow that particular group to deploy. And then, of course, last but not least, go ahead and launch the program and begin the application portal. Platform is already there. We've used this from CAP before. We just need to tweak the back end a little bit, but it will not take long to get that program up and running and out the door. This person is not here. I use my New York tone. Bree Henderson is one of our new associates, and of course our department. We also have Mr. Wayne Green here as well, and then my other colleague, Mr. Nahal Vasti. And so all questions regarding the program can go directly to Bree.
Well done.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
It is exactly.
Did I hit it? Okay.
Thank you. You should run before they start asking questions.
I have a 5-second question.
Yes,
going back to the commercial corridor pilot program slide,
yep.
You had the grant amount and then units. So per unit, like for example, the reimbursable grant, mm-hmm. It said 2 units, 35,000. So each one of those two, I'm assuming those are units are applicants. And are they each awarded an amount up to $35,000, or the total pool is $35,000 to be split amongst two people?
Great question. Yes. So
grant amount itself and just on reimbursable, that grant amount would be $35,000.
And that was the dollar amount that we had in the previous cash.
Times two or per?
Per.
Okay, per. Okay.
Per business, yes. Right. I think that's what the question is. The number two, and just in actuality, that actually should be a 4. I double-checked that a little earlier today. And that's just based on the funding that we have left over from FY22. But again, we're going to do the application for CDBG for more money, which will be ready to go by fiscal year 24.
And last piece, advertising that this program is happening and connecting to businesses here. Because I think that was one of the things, and I appreciate this, for existing, because the work that we did with the Mayor's Commission for SEO,
mm-hmm.
I recall a particular person saying, please don't let this sit on the shelf.
Yes.
And there's no forward movement, so I'm happy to see movement. But now how are you going to connect these opportunities to businesses?
Yes, correct. So number one, directly into the communities, that's going to be primary. There's a reason why I started physically going to our task force and our business association so we can make sure we get the word out with the rest of the team. Secondly, I do go back to the ecosystem partners because that's crucial because a lot of those businesses are in their infant stages and they say, hey, I'm ready for brick and mortar. So that will be another great audience that we can get in front of in order to make that transition as well. And then we do have our other traditional means that we've always had access to, which is the social medias, the newsletters, the websites. But very much so more of a one-on-one intimate approach is what we're looking for.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you
so much. Mr. Poole.
Mayor, I apologize. I failed to mention earlier, we're grateful to have representatives today from the Center for Policing Equity with us all day, spending time with staff. you've hung in there throughout the entire work session. Do you mind just stand up and introduce yourself briefly?
Oh, yeah. Thanks for having us, actually. I'm Marcus McKinney. I'm our government affairs principal for the ComStaff for Justice program. So we're here on a site visit. I've been visiting council members, working with the community. So I appreciate the opportunity to view the session. I feel like we definitely got an adequate sense of how council operates. So thank you.
Great to be here today, so thank you for that.
Please introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Emma Embleton. I am the community engagement coordinator for the C4J team.
Thank you both for being here.
And then our, colleagues over there.
We're Brad. Candace Williams, community engagement manager. And I'm Brittany Caviasco, lead and director of community engagement.
Thank you all for being here. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Glad you got a chance to see how government actually works. All right, Mr. Bull.
I move that members of the council assemble informally in closed meeting on November 29, 2022 at 6:30 p.m. in the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building of the City of Norfolk for the purposes which are set out in clauses 1 and 29 of subsection A of section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 1, discussion of prospective candidates for boards, commissions, authorities, and work committee. Clause 29, discussion of public contract amendment in the downtown area. What terms of the scope or scope of such contract and open discussion would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body? Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Mrs. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
Bring close, sir.